So good afternoon, all of you. I'm Satish Kumar, and we'll be looking at a limit state method in the first half of this lecture. You may be aware that the basic code for steel design, IS 800, was revised to limit state method in 2007. Before that, we already had a reinforced concrete code in limit state method. But there are the many clearer aspects of limit state method have come out in minute detail in this code. So we'll just have a quick look at this, and as an introduction, we'll say that basically idea of a structural design is that the designer has to ensure that the structures that he designs are functional, that is, they satisfy the serviceability requirements, then they are safe, that is, with some reliability, and they are economical and durable. Durability is in a way linked to economy, because if something is not durable, we need to replace it again. So these are the basic things. Now, unfortunately, the more safe you try to make, the more uneconomical it becomes, or the more economical you make, the more unsafe it becomes. So there is a delicate balance between safety and economy, which we need to strike. And this we achieve through a way of thought, which is called the design philosophy. And as such, there are several design philosophies. And these design philosophies make use of some analysis methods and some dictums on design. Okay. So the problem with civil engineering structures is that we have uncertainties associated with both the load as well as the response. So basically, we do calculations saying that this much is the load or the effect of the load in terms of shear force bending moment diagram, and this much is the resistance, but in reality, these are not really clearly definable. Okay, so we have uncertainties associated with each of the load components, their combinations, and similarly the resistance component. We also have uncertainty associated with our analysis methods. They just give us some idea of how the structure is going to behave, but they have their own limitations. So we need to understand all this and then develop a design philosophy which will be able to give us both safe and reliable economical structures. Okay. So in terms of variability of loading, we know that the loads are normally defined as the dead loads, which are permanent loads, the live loads, which are variable loads as per the new code. We call them actions rather than loads. And then we have some natural forces like wind loads and earthquake loads. So all these are variable to different extents. For example, the dead load can be fairly accurately calculated, although there will be some errors due to other materials which are also present in a structure, such as the walls are made of bricks or block work or whatever. They may be plastered to different thicknesses than what we assume, and so on. But then it can be fairly accurately determined. The live loads are the loads that are imposed on the structure by the people, the furniture, and other equipment which are present on the structure, and these vary quite a bit. And then we have the other loads, that is the wind loads and the earthquake loads, which are natural forces, and they can vary considerably. So we need to understand all these loads and see how we can design a structure which is safe to the required extent, and at the same time economical, because if we try to make it safe for the worst combination of these loads, then it becomes very uneconomical. Okay. So we also have problems with the variability of material strengths and other properties like ductility. So for example, we assume that a particular steel will have so much yield strength, but in reality, as it's manufactured, it may have higher or lower strengths. Okay. So we need to define on up to what level of strength variability the steel is acceptable. So they do carry out quality control tests in the steel plants, but then the final steel produced is not exactly always matching the requirements, and it will have some variability. Similarly, we will have variability in the dimensions of the structure. We may assume a thickness of a plate as 10 mm. But it may be 9.99 or 10.02 mm, whatever. So there will be some variability in the structural dimensions. Then another important variability which we don't realize very often is that the analysis method that we use is always an approximate method. This is because we want to keep the analysis very simple. So in that sense, we try to keep the analysis simple, and we accept that there could be some other effects like stress concentration effects, etc., which could be there in the structure, which we are not captured in our analysis. So we need to be aware of that, and then the design philosophy has to be able to cater to such variabilities. So till now, for a long time, we were using what is called as the working stress method, wherein we defined something called a characteristic load, which is defined as the load which will not be exceeded, more than 5% of the times. So we define not the mean load, but a load which is higher than that, which is called the characteristic load. And similarly, we define a characteristic strength, which is again on the lower side. So it's not the normal mean strength that we always get, but much lower strength, which will so that the real strength will not be less than that, less than 5% of the time. So like that, we define the characteristic strength in a probabilistic sense, and then we ensure that the load or the load effect is less than the strength divided by a factor of safety. This factor of safety is the margin between strength and load, which helps us account for the uncertainties that are associated in both the load as well as in the strength. Okay, so the characteristic strength divided by the factor of safety is also called the allowable strength, or the allowable corresponding stress is called the allowable stress. It's also called a working stress. Okay, it is a fraction of the typically the yield strength as far as steel is concerned. The allowable stress may be defined in terms of a factor of safety, which represents the margin for overload and other unknown factors which could be tolerated by the structure. So we should remember that the load can exceed the characteristic load that we have assumed, or the design load that we have assumed in the design. And in such cases, the factor of safety will help us to ensure adequate margin of safety. Okay. So now, what are the limitations of this method? The advantages, of course, the analysis is simple. We assume elastic behavior, linear elastic behavior, and we can use any standard analysis procedure, and then based on that, we calculate shear force, bending moments, etc., and then we calculate the corresponding stress produced, and we design for that. Okay. So, but unfortunately, the real materials are non-linear beyond a limit that is called the yield strength. Beyond that, they plastify and they elongate. Okay, so that part is not accounted for in the working stress method, and sometimes the post yield behavior is not accounted in the working stress method. And what happens is, steel being a ductile material, if the load exceeds or the stress tries to exceed the yield strength, the steel will limit it to yield, and it will yield. And as a consequence, the load will be transferred to some other place, and that is called the redistribution of stresses or moments, and that again is not very well accounted for in working stress method. So as a consequence, what happens is, different structures, let's say I take a simply supported beam and I take a fixed beam, the simply supported beam, I assume a factor of safety of, let's say, 1.67, it may give me the exact factor of safety. That means if I increase the load by 1.67, it may collapse. Whereas the fixed beam, if I increase the load by 1.67, it will not collapse. It will have plastic hinges forming, and then as a consequence, redistribution of moments will occur, and the actual factor of safety will be much higher than what we have assumed, which means we have got an oversafe structure but an uneconomical structure. So we want to have sort of uniform factor of safety for all these structures. So what we do, what we are saying is, in other words, the working stress method is sometimes irrational, and it gives generally uneconomical design. So this ability of the structure to deform, which is called ductility, if it can be taken into account, probably we can reduce the margin of safety, and then we'll get a more economical structure. So that is what we are trying to do in the limit state method. Okay. So in simple terms, if we say in the working stress method, we just saw that the load effect has to be less than the strength divided by a factor of safety. Now what we are going to do is, this factor of safety, we are going to split into two partial safety factors. One is called the load factor, which will go to the, from here denominator, it will go to the left hand side, and it will become a load factor. So the characteristic load is now amplified by a factor called the load factor, and the characteristic strength is now divided by a factor called material factor. And the load factor and the material factor will again, what values we choose will depend on what is their variability. If the values are very definitely known, we can choose as close as 1. Okay, if the values are likely to vary quite a lot, then we may have to choose a higher value. Like for example, we choose a load factor typically of about 1.5. Okay. So that is how we look at we change it to the limit state method. Okay, then let's just look at what are the factors which contribute to the uncertainties that we normally find. So first is of course the strength of the material, then the geometry or the configuration, then cross sectional dimensions, inaccuracies in the strength calculations. These are the factors which contribute to the material or the structural uncertainty. Then there is uncertainty in the actions, that is the loads itself. So the actual loads would be quite different from the assumed loads that we have taken for in design. Okay, so that is the other part of the issue. So now let's see how we understand this variability in the of loads in a probabilistic sense. So what we are going to plot is, we are going to plot the frequency or the number of times a particular value of strength or load occurs as against the actual value on the x-axis. Okay, so in the x-axis, for example, if qm is the load pack, then we are going to plot that here, and it occurs so many number of times, so that point is coming here. And as I increase the load, so let's say if the typical live load for a office building, let's say, is assumed as 4 kilonewton per meter square. So this will be something like let's say about 3 kilonewtons. That is the normally occurring live load in a regular office building. And then as I increase it further and further, 4, 5, 6, like etc., the number of times it will occur will go on reducing. Similarly, as I reduce it to from 3 to 2, 1, 0.5, etc., again the frequency will reduce. So we get a probabilistic distribution, which is normally assumed as Gaussian distribution, and the mean value is denoted as Qm, that is the mean value of the load. Similarly, the strength, if I assume let's say mild steel of strength Fy as 250 MPa, then what we are getting is, most of the time we will get 250 MPa, but sometimes it will go higher or lower. So generally, if you find when you buy steel, you buy mild steel, and you will find that most of the average strength will be around 270 MPa. That is how they will produce the steel, so that it always satisfy your requirement of 250 MPa. And as I increase, sometimes it may become 290, 310, and so on. So, but the number of times will come down. Similarly, sometimes it may come down from 270, it may come down to 260, 250, and so on. And very rarely, it may even be as low as 240 MPa. Okay. So we understand that that is also variable. And we want to separate these two, in the sense that I want the mean strength to be separated from the mean load, or to be higher. That means it should be on the right hand side, so that I get a margin of safety. Okay. So what we are trying to say is that the factor of safety will be determined which as the distance that is minimum required to push the strength curve to the right hand side of the load curve, so that the intersection point, which is a very rare possibility of the load being little more than what we have assumed, or the strength being much less than what we have assumed. So as a adverse combination of the load and the strength, we could have failure. So we want to make the failure, possibility of failure, the bare minimum. Okay. So that is what we are trying to do here. So in other words, if we plot, let's say the load, strength minus load, we will get a graph like this. The two graphs will merge into a single graph, and we will have this area where the strength is less than the load as the unsafe region, and we want to reduce this unsafe region to a minimum. At the same time, if we try to make it 10 to 0, then what will happen is, we will get very safe structures, but they will not be economical. Okay, and the so we are taking a calculated risk, and that is denoted by a factor called beta, which is we'll see in the next slide. Beta is denoted as the safety index. Okay, so it is actually given by this formula, and the probability of failure is a function phi of this safety index beta. So Now you can see here for various values of beta, the probabilities of failures are listed out, and we find that if I choose beta as 2.32, the probability of failure is 1 in 100, that 0.01. Okay, so that means one structure in 100 structures is likely to fail, or one beam in 100 beams that we design can fail. Okay, so we don't want that. We don't, because civil engineering structures are very important structures and they cause loss of life. So we don't like to have such a high probability of failure. So we want to increase the beta value. Now the typically accepted beta value is for normal structures like houses or buildings is 4.75, which gives a probability of failure of 1 in 10 to the power 6, that is a million. So if that is the normal value chosen for routine structures. For important structures like, let's say, dams or nuclear power plants, we might even use a higher probability, a higher beta value, so that the probability of failure is further reduced. And for temporary structures, we might use a slightly lower beta value, so that we can quickly finish off the work and probably remove the temporary structure before the load exceeds the expected value. Okay, so that can be done. So typically, we choose 4.75, and the probability of failure is 1 in 10 to the power minus 6. Now loads also, we should remember that they don't act individually, right? There is always some dead load, live load, and then sometimes the earthquake load or wind load will act. So all these might combine together. So what we do is, we instead of applying the load factor individually, we can also apply the load factor to combinations of loads. So we take a summation of the various loads Qk, where K is the type of load, like dead load, live load, etc., and you can apply the load factor gamma L to the individual loads, or we can apply to the combination. Similarly, for the strength, there could be different strengths involved in the same design. We will see that in the next presentation. And depending on the type of strength involved, we can probably choose the gamma M, or the material safety factor. Okay. So what we are doing is, now we are defining the limit states which are required for design. And there are basically two types of limit states. One is called the ultimate limit state, which are those catastrophic states which require a larger reliability or lower probability of failure in order to basically to reduce the probability to a low level. And then there are serviceable limit states. These are basically refer to the limits on acceptable performance of the structure during service. So let's say if there is a building, and this building is under normal conditions, it's working very well, but let's say once in a year it has some vibrations, okay, or due to some when the winds are very heavy, so that may be acceptable. So in that case, we will say that it's still acceptable. So that's how we'll define what is the acceptable limit state, and then we verify the corresponding responses. That is, in terms of load, we talk of stresses or the strength. And in terms of serviceability, we might talk of deflection or vibration, etc. Okay. And basically, the idea now is structures to be designed for the limit state at which they would become unfit for their intended purpose by choosing appropriate partial safety factors based on probabilistic methods. But we are not directly bringing probability here. We are indirectly bringing it in the form of the partial safety factors, one applied to the load, which is called the load factor, and another the material, which is called the material strength factor. Okay, so these are used. So the load factor gamma L in turn allows for possible deviation of the actual behavior of the structure from the analysis model. So it accounts for the approximations in the analysis. It accounts for deviation of loads from specified values, and it accounts also sometimes when we apply it for a combination of load, we take into account the reduced probability that all those loads will reach their maximum values at the same time. So we will see that when we look at the factors given by the code IS 800, we will realize that when we combine more than two factors, how we reduce the load factor. Okay. The material safety factor in its turn accounts for the position of the material in the structure from the values that are assumed in design. Then possible reduction in the strength of the material from its characteristic value. There could be some manufacturing tolerances. So we want, as I said, a 10 mm plate, but it could be 9.9 mm. So we may not be able to discard the plate always. So we may have to accept that plate. And if it is less than some tolerance, that let's say we specify plus or minus 2 mm as tolerance, 0.2 mm, then if it goes below 9.8, then we will discard the plate. We will go and get a plate which is thicker than that. Okay. And it also accounts for the sometimes for the mode of failure. What is the method by which the failure occurs? So the limit states as such, they are listed out here. Now the limit state of strength, we have strength as governed by material yielding or whatever, then strength as governed by buckling, which the material yielding is normally for steel, it is defined by the yield strength of the material Fy. Okay. The buckling strength is normally defined by the Young's modulus E. Okay. And then you have stability against overturning, sway, etc. So these are overall stability limits. Then there could be fatigue and brittle fracture. So these are the limit states of strength. In the limit states of serviceability, we have deflection as a possible criteria, which could make a structure maybe not difficult to use, but it's like not comfortable to use, I would say. And then we have vibration, then sometimes fatigue cracks which can be repaired, then corrosion, which is also called a limit state of durability, and then fire resistance. So these are the other limit states which we should verify a structure, a design against. Okay. Now coming to the contents of section 5 of the code IS 800, the title is limit state design. It gives you the basis for design, then it talks about what is limit state design, then 5.3 talks about the loads which are actually called actions in the code, and 5.4 talks about the strength. So in the actions we get the load factors that are defined, under strengths the material safety factors are defined, and then the factors governing the ultimate strength like stability, fatigue, plastic collapse, and factors which govern the limit state of serviceability, that is deflection, vibration, durability, and fire resistance. Okay. So these are the things. So now basis of design, the code says that the structure shall be designed to withstand safely all loads likely to act on it throughout its life. So we assume a certain life for each structure. Let's say for a typical structure, we assume a life of about 50 years, and we say that the chances of this amount of load coming in 50 years is this much, and we want to make that probability of failure like 1 in million. Okay. And remember that this load will not always come on the structure, it may come once in the life of the structure. So that, so what it means is the structures which are standing currently need not always be safe. Okay, because the ultimate load or the limit load may not have come as of today. So when that load comes, it should survive. Okay. Then it shall also satisfy the serviceability requirements, such as limitations of deflection and vibration. So these are also defined. And it says that the structure shall not suffer total collapse under accidental loads, such as from explosions or impact, or due to consequences of human error, to an extent beyond the local damages. Or in other words, what they say is the amount of damage caused should not be disproportionate, in the sense it should not be much more than the cost. So a small cost like some explosion in a particular part of the structure should have only local damage, it should not cause the entire structure to collapse. Okay. So that is something which we have to verify. Then the objective of design is to achieve a structure that will remain fit for use during its life with an acceptable target reliability. In other words, the probability of failure is below the expected 1 in a million value. Okay. Then coming to the loads, you know that there are variety of loads acting on the structure. So these are defined as or classified as permanent actions, such as due to the self weight of the structural and non-structural components like fittings, ancillaries and other equipment which are permanently fixed. Then variable actions, actions due to construction and service stage loads like live loads, crane loads, snow loads, wind loads and earthquake loads. And then there is a new class of loads which is defined, which is called accidental actions, actions due to explosions, impact of vehicles and fires. These actions or values of these actions have to be determined by the engineer on a case by case basis. Okay. So coming to the partial safety factors for loads or actions, We find that there's a table given like this, where the combination of loads are listed on the left hand side, and here we have limit state of strength and limit state of serviceability. So under limit state of strength, we have dead loads. Then the live load is again classified into two groups. One is called the leading live load, and the another is called the accompanying live load. We have to understand that, for example, if it's an industrial building, I could have a crane load acting when the crane comes over a particular column, and then I could also have the live load on the roof. Okay. Now both these loads may have different effects. The live load on the roof will produce maybe more load above the in the column above the crane level, and a crane load will produce more load in the bending moments in the column part of the column below that crane level. Okay. So depending on the case, if one load, the leading live load is one which is trying to push the structure towards collapse, and the accompanying live load is a load which is just sitting and giving some extra value or some partial help to the leading live load. So that is how they are defined, and these can be interchanged. So once I'll explain like this. For example, we want to combine dead load plus live load plus crane load CL. What we might do is we might combine 1.5 dead load, 1.5 if I assume the crane load as the leading live load, then 1.5 crane load plus 1.05 live load. So what I'm saying is, when the crane is lifting to its full capacity, the number of people on the roof may not be very high. Okay, or when the other way around, when I say 1.5 DL plus 1.5 live load and 1.505 crane load, then what we are saying is, when the people are high sitting on the roof to do some repair or whatever, that time the crane may not lift the full capacity. So the chances of both this happening are low, so we are reducing the load factor for the accompanying load. Okay, and this has to be now checked. So we will have two combinations here, this and this with the leading 1.5 leading live load and 1.05 accompanying. Then the two loads will be switched, and again we'll have 1.5 times the other leading live load, and what was leading now has become accompanying. So that is how we are switching the two. So we have two combinations here itself. You will have similarly two combinations here also, like the dead load, live load, crane load, wind load. So what now we are bringing one more load which is acting along with the live load and crane load. So what we realize is, the chances of this happening are low, so we will reduce that factor from 1.5 to 1.2. Okay, and if we are to using 1.2 for this and 1.05 for the accompanying load, then the wind load, earthquake load factor will be only 0.6. But if we are using 1.2 for the leading live load and 0.53 for the accompanying, then we will take 1.2 for the wind load or the earthquake load. So that is how two more combinations will occur here, and we will have probably four combinations to check. Okay. Similarly, when we combine dead load directly with wind load or earthquake load, we have either factor of 1.5 DL plus 1.5 wind load earthquake load, which could give sometimes the higher movements, etc., or 0.9 dead load plus 1.5 wind load. Because what happens in several structures, like let's say the light roof structures, we might have the dead load is actually opposing, or the wind load is opposing the dead load. So wind dead load is downwards, wind load is trying to lift the roof up. So if the dead load has slightly lesser value than what we have calculated, to account for that we are taking it as 0.9, and then we are checking that if this is becomes 1.5 times more, whether the roof is safe, it should not fly off. So that is the other combination. Similarly, dead load plus erection load, we have to also check for that. In steel, it is very important to understand how the structure is going to be erected, like how the members are going to be lifted and placed in position and how they will be connected. So whatever loads come, they should be able to the structure should be able to withstand in the erection stage also. And then, as I said, dead load, live load, accidental load. So again, accidental loads occur for very short durations of time, so the live load factor has been reduced to 0.35, and wind load is, or earthquake loads may not be occurring at that time, so we take a factor for AL as 1. Okay, so directly we are checking for the full load that is coming due to accident, we are not amplifying the load like we did here. So that gives us a fairly good safety against such accidents. Okay, and then coming to limit state of serviceability, typically we are supposed to be using all the factors as one, but the code gives some advantage in the sense when you are combining more than one variable load, like dead load, live load, crane load, and wind load. Crane load may not be there in many cases. So let's say dead load, live load, and wind load, then you are able to reduce the factor for the variable load to 0.8. Okay, so this is not stated, but this is how the code has given in the that table. Okay, so this is how we will be checking that. Then ultimate strength calculations may require consideration of loss of equilibrium of the structure or any part of it considered as a rigid body. That means we are talking about overturning of the structure as a whole, etc., or failure by excessive deformation, rupture, or loss of stability of the structure, etc. So sometimes what will happen is the structure may yield, and there could be a sway, and as a consequence of sway, some extra bending movements called P delta or second order effects may come. So all that also could cause failure. Okay, so all that we are going to now get in check by taking the design strength SD as the ultimate strength divided by the partial safety factor for material gamma m. Okay, so we will realize this maybe better when we look at the design of tension members, but as of now the partial safety factors for strength calculations are given like this. When the strength or resistance is governed by yielding, that is when we say that the failure is going to occur by yielding, then we use a partial safety factor of 1.1. This is also denoted as gamma m0. Okay, so Fy will always be divided by gamma m0, and then you will get what is called as FYD, that is the design yield strength. Okay, and that could be used to calculate the moment of resistance, etc., etc. Similarly, when the resistance of a member is from buckling consideration, that is the Young's modulus plays a role. So we use the same gamma m0, which is again defined as 1.1. Then when the resistance is governed by ultimate stress Fu, then we will be using gamma m1 as 1.25. This is because steels are graded based on their yield strength. So when I say yield strength is 250, the ultimate strength could be 410, 415, 420, whatever. We generally don't have much idea about it. So that is why that is a larger variability with Fu. So the factor for Fu is also larger. Okay. Similarly, when it comes to connections, you have bolts. We'll see these types later on. Friction type or bearing type, then you can have rivets, then you can have welds. So these are different methods of connecting members together to form a structure, and essentially they have several problems or several issues. One is their quality issue is there. What will be the strength of a bolt that you buy, etc., etc. The other important issue is what is the actual load or the stress coming on a particular bolt. When you have a group of bolts, different bolts may have different stresses. So that again we do a approximate analysis, but in reality due to their fitting and exact I mean the size of the hole, etc., some bolts may experience a slightly larger stress than other bolts. Okay, so as we up increase the load, possibly that bolt might fail earlier than the other bolts. So to cater for that, we have a safety factor of 1.25 for all these, except for the last point, which is what is called as field welds or welds which are done in the site. So these again have a quality issue because they are done under field conditions where dust and other things may be there, or the welding equipment may not be of adequate quality, or the position at which the welder is sitting and welding may not be comfortable. So he may not do a very good weld. So for that, we have the factor has been defined as 1.5. Okay, so this will this is how we will use the corresponding factors. Now we go back to our design criteria which we were using for working stress method and the limit state method. So in the working stress method, we realized that the load should be less than the strength by a factor of safety. We were using a factor of safety of about 1.67. Okay, so that 1.67 is essentially split now into a factor LF, which is 1.5, and the material factor, which is 1.1. So 1.5 into 1.1 will give you around 1.65. So what has happened is, when the code has been revised from working stress to limit state, the safety margins or the safety levels are kept constant, because the any further reduction will require additional data on both the loads that are acting, their probabilities of occurrence, as well as the material strengths and their quality control. So all these are required. So that has not been touched at all. Only thing that has been done is, now this factor is 1.5 when you combine two of the loads. To combine more than two, then it becomes 1.2 and all. So that gives us an advantage in our economy in the design. Okay, so that is one more thing. Then factors governing the ultimate strength are against overturning and sway. Fatigue and plastic collapse are other factors which also sometimes govern. We'll see that later on, how we tackle that. Coming to limit state of serviceability, deflections are to be checked for the most adverse but realistic combination of service loads and their arrangement by elastic analysis using a load factor of 1. So basically what it says is, since the service loads are much lower, the structure is likely to be more or less elastic under such loads and their combination. So you can use an elastic analysis, and you can use a load factor of 1 or 0.8 as per the table, and then you need to check the deflections are within the limits. Then similarly, we need to also, for special structures where like vibration or fatigue could be an issue, we would check for those effects. And the durability also has been now covered in section 15. Basically, it gives you a type of paint coatings or systems wherein we apply primer, paint, and etc. to ensure a certain life, because we don't want a well-designed structure to get out of service within a short period. Okay, so durability becomes another issue. And then very some rare cases, some fire could also become an issue. So that is discussed in section 6. Okay. Now coming to the limiting deflections, previous code used to give a typical value of span by 325. Okay, for all deflections, all loads, under all loads, etc. But the new code realizes that it is too stringent in some cases and too less in some other cases. So it gives you deflections. And peculiar thing about steel is that steel members can be bent a little bit upwards, or even the trusses are designed such a way that the midspan deflections can be nullified by while fabricating the truss itself. Okay, so as soon as we put the structure, the dead load will start acting on it due to gravity, and as such, that whatever is the deflection can always be compensated. So that is not going to affect the performance of the structure generally. So these deflections are under live load only. Okay, so that means we have to check the deflections only under the live loads. And here type of building is given, then the type of deflection vertical is given. And if it is under live load, for example, for purlins, girts, etc., or for simple splans, again two classification is given. If they are supporting elastic cladding, that means a metal sheet. So if the purlin deflects a little bit, the metal sheet will bend and there would not be any problem. So the deflection limits are less stringent. That is, for example, span by 150. But if it is supporting like a brittle material like AC sheet or thermocol or some other or let's say calcium silicate board or some such thing, such sheeting which cannot bend much, if you bend more, it will break. Okay. So then the limits become little more stringent. So 150 becomes 180 or 240 becomes 300 and so on. So like that, starting from a very high value of permissible deflection, we are making it more and more stringent. For cranes, the limits become span by 500, span by 750 and so on, depending on the type of operation. Okay. So these are again obtained from the crane manufacturers as to what deflection is permissible for the crane to smoothly operate. Then these are the deflections under lateral and the vertical directions for other types of members. So these are the values. So this is an extensive table is given, and we need to check the corresponding values for the corresponding checks. So to summarize now the silent features of this code, it gives more rational and often more economical designs, gives a lot of freedom compared to the 1984 code to the designer. And remember, with freedom comes some responsibility, so we need to check maybe a few more equations sometimes. Enable simple or complicated design procedures. Some people find that the new code looks complicated, but we can always simplify the procedures. Only thing is, we will not get very economical structures, which is okay in some cases, and provides all the information for design, such as bolt strength, weld strength, etc. Our equations are given to enable use of spreadsheets like Excel sheets, and it closely follows the Euro code but includes original treatments where required. Then a concept of semi-rigid connections has been brought back, okay, which was there in the 1962 code, but now it has again been brought back. It covers new topics such as durability, fire, fatigue, and earthquake resistant design. So it become a comprehensive code which could give a safe and economical design. So it also says, please note that many of the complexities on the revised IS 800 are not due to changes in just changing from working stress to design. We have not limit state, we have not changed anything. We have changed 1.67 as 1.5 and 1.1, right? So multiply, you get almost the same value. But the complications are due to advances made in steel design over the years, which help in a more rational and reliable estimate of the collapse load. So what has happened is, many of these new equations that are there in the code, they are more empirical in nature. People have done lot of tests, lot of analysis, and then based on that, they have brought these equations for design. So they look little complicated, but they are not very difficult. You can always calculate them with a scientific calculator. Okay. So that ends the first part of the presentation. I would like to continue into the second one, that is design of tension members. Okay. Somebody has a question. So why can't the deflection be considered for dead load? Because structure may have long term deflection due to constant loading. Where it is a requirement that this deflection is likely to affect the performance of the structure, we could consider that deflection due to dead load also. Code doesn't say anything about that, but what it says is that if your deflection due to live load is within these limits, then the other deflections can be taken care of by pre-cambering the girder or the truss or whatever. Okay, so that is the idea behind. So we proceed to the second presentation, that is design of tension members. And here we'll look at introduction, behavior of tension members, plates under tension, threaded rods, angles under tension, and then the codal provisions. Okay, so the tension basically steel is good in tension. So what we should actually try and do, or what people generally try to do, is to put as many members in tension as possible. So the structural form itself is chosen such that more members can go in tension. Okay. So here are some examples. Like, we have, let's say, a roof truss. So the bottom cord is generally a under gravity loads. When the loads act downwards, the bottom cord tends to go into tension. So that is also called a tie. A tie is another name for a tension member. Then we can have a building where this pink one is the core of the building, which goes into compression. And then we build the building from top to bottom. We suspend each floor from top downwards. Okay, these are like hanging the, so this is still economical because the core may be made of concrete, it may be made of a slip form concrete, whatever. And then if we suspend all this, then you will find that these columns will not have any buckling problem. So you need very thin rods to suspend the entire floor. Okay, and this can be easily done, and we will find that this type of building also becomes economical. And we also use some rods called sag rods in industrial buildings, where we try to reduce the purlin deflections by putting these sag rods, which actually enable us to, it's like again suspending those trusses, so those purlins one after the other on the roof. Okay. Then we have bracings, which under lateral loads often go into tension. Okay. So these are examples of tension members. And the characteristics of tension members are, the members experience axial force, and as a consequence of the axial load, they will tend to stretch or elongate. And then the stress is also uniform over the entire cross section, except at or near the supports. The most of the middle part of the member, the stress will be very uniform, and this gives us a very efficient member because we are using the material to the full extent. Okay. So the strength will generally be governed by the material strength, that is the yield strength of the steel. Then if you put bolt holes or rivet holes or whatever, then you are going to cut the cross section, and then that will reduce the strength. So, but they are sometimes required for connecting the member. So we can't avoid always these holes, but they play a major role in reducing the strength of the member. Now, since the member is under tension, so all that we need is cross sectional area into the yield stress should be equal to the tension that is going to come on the member. So we are not here looking at moments of inertia, etc., etc. So any cross section which has that required area will be adequate. Okay, so that is another advantage. And as such, we try to choose sections which are easy to connect. Okay. So the most common member, tension member, is generally the angle. So angles are used in roof trusses, they are used in brazings, in buildings, and so on. And it could be a single angle, it could be a double angle. This is because they are very easy to connect. Okay. And these are also called open sections, so they are more easy to connect. If the angle is not adequate, we might sometimes go for a channel or an I section, etc. Like in big bridges for railways, etc., we might go for I sections or even built up sections like what are shown here. Other types of tension members are a rod, that is a circular cross section, or a cable. Okay. The rods are still okay, we can probably thread them and then connect them using nuts, whereas cables require special anchoring system. Okay. So that is the only problem. But cables also have another type of non-linearity, which is called geometric non-linearity. So we should be careful. If the cable sags when we are using, then that means it is not going to behave as per our normal analysis. Okay. Now, behavior of a tension member, basically we are now going to take a rod and apply a tension. So we are going to pull the rod. So it will reflect the stress strain behavior. So I have actually, you know that stress strain curve for mild steel starts from the origin. There is a what you call a proportional limit, where the stress is proportional to strain, and the constant of proportionality is your Young's modulus. And when you reach the yield stress, the material yields, and there will be a yield large yield plateau. The strain goes on increasing, but at constant stress, and then it strain hardens, and then it reaches another value which is called the ultimate stress Fu, beyond which the stress strain curve drops down. Okay, so the same behavior now is reflected in the load deformation curve, because load is nothing but stress into area. So it is just scaling up of the stress by a factor called area, right? So it is just stress into area. Similarly, the delta, which is like TL by AE. So T by A is your stress, and L by AE becomes the when you do that, you get the strain. So so the strain is scaled up now into a total elongation of the member. So the stress strain curve and the load deflection curve for a tension member are exactly similar. So if I apply tension, I will have up to here, I'll have tension proportional to the elongation, and after that, at this will be the yield load, or at which the member will yield, and it will elongate quite a bit, because real members are several meters long, so this elongation could be considerable. And then after that, it might strain harden, and finally it will rupture at a particular point. Okay. So, but this elongation itself may not be acceptable for us in many structures. So we would limit our strength to Fy, okay, or the corresponding Ty. So we will say that Ty, which is equal to Fy into A, constitutes the limit state of collapse for mild steel. When it comes to high strength steel, you don't have a well-defined yield point. What happens is the curve goes up, and then it gradually curves up, and then it comes like this. Since there is no yield point, what we do is we take 0.2% strain, we draw a line parallel to the initial elastic stiffness, and wherever this line cuts, that is known as the proof strength. Okay, it is equivalent to the yield strength. So that is the yield strength, and again it also has an Fu, but it fails quite often at a lower elongation or strain compared to mild steel. Okay. So the code says that whichever high strength steel you use, it should have at least some amount of elongation, which is measured in percentage. So typically it might be about 20%, 22%, and so on. Okay. So only if you have that kind of elongation, you can use the high strength steel and design. So that was for a typical tension member. But what happens is, as I said, we can't always use tension members just like that. We sometimes need to put holes to connect them. So whatever, when you put a hole in a tension member, you in what happens is the uniform stress that you have away tends to concentrate at the edges of the hole. So you have a stress concentration, because of which the stress here is much more than the average stress. So average stress we will calculate as T divided by the after cutting the hole, whatever area is remaining, this orange area is the cross section at this hole location. So this is called a net area. So whatever is the net area, so T divided by net area gives the average stress, whereas the stress at this point is much more than the average stress. But that is not a problem. Even if this stress reaches yield stress, that particular point will yield, but as such there will be no elongation of the member. Okay, so here it is shown, as we increase the load, the stress may reach yield stress, and once it remains at yield, so the next fiber will start yielding, and subsequently all the fibers will yield at the net section. Even that is not a failure, because the total length of the member has not become much. Okay, the yield has occurred only over a very short length of the member, so it will not increase the length of the member as a whole. Whereas if the cross section yields, that is this section yields, then every cross section yields, and then the member may become pretty long. Okay, so now we if that does not happen, then we can further increase the load until the net section reaches FU, which is the rupture, which will constitute physical breaking or rupture of the plate into two. Okay, so that is where we say that the plate has failed. Okay, so this is for a plate with tower. Now, how do we bring this now into design? We'll see. Before that, let's look at this interesting case where I have two holes in a single section. So my net area in this case of plate width is B. The whole diameter is D and thickness is T. So B minus 2D is what I have left as the plate after cutting the holes, as the width of the plate available into T gives me the net area for this case. But suppose I put the second hole far away from the first hole, somewhere along the member, then what happens is at this cross section I will have only one hole to deduct. So the net area becomes B minus only 1D into T. Okay, at this section, at this section also the net area is the same. Okay, so we find that case A, the net area is less than the case B. Now what will happen if I start moving the second hole closer and closer to the first hole? At some point what will happen is the holes will interact, or the stress concentrations will overlap, and the failure will occur along this dashed line 1 2 3 4. Okay, so at this point the failure occurs by rupture along this net section, and this net section area will be between this case A and case B. So what will be that area which we should use to exactly predict the failure strength? So that has been found out by by both analysis and experiments, and we define this distance along the, so we are assuming that the load direction is horizontal. So the direction along the load is the pitch P of the bolt hole, and the direction perpendicular to the load is the gauge distance G. This arrow should have come actually here along this hole. So center to center distance between the holes in the vertical direction is G. Okay, so this is pitch and this is gauge. So if you have pitch P and gauge, the A net area is now given by B minus N times D plus summation of P square by 4G. So what it says is, we'll go back one time, for every inclined leg you add 1 P square by 4G. Okay, so you continue with a net area as B minus 2D. You deduct for the two holes which are coming along the dashed section, and then you add 1 P square by 4G into that expression, and you will get the correct net area for this case. Okay, so when you have a case like this where there are multiple holes and the failure may go through these holes, that is interaction of these stress concentrations, then number of inclined legs 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So n will be 6, and similarly summation will also be over those 6 inclined legs. Sorry, n here will be now 7 because number of holes are 7, and p square by 4g is now 6 times to be added, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so that is how we calculate the net area. So this gives us a very good estimate of how the plate will fail under net section rupture. Angles, when they are loaded through gussets, they have a special problem. Here also again we have stress concentration. Now angles are in the cross section, they look like this. They normally are connected only by one leg to the gusset plate because the other leg is outstanding. So gusset plates may not be available for connecting that leg. So what happens is, away from the connection you have uniform stress, and this is the stress resultant at that section, which is at the CG of the angle, which will be somewhere here. Okay, and this force is now actually distributed as stress over the entire cross section. Now as I come closer and closer, all this stress finally has to flow into through this bolt hole or weld, whatever we have, through that connection into the gusset plate, and the force has to go in here. So we also find there is a small eccentricity between this resistance and the load. So there is a small eccentricity, and the plate, gusset plate may bend at this location little bit to adjust for that. But essentially this part of the outstanding leg is stress free, because this edge there is no stress from outside. So if I cut it, there has to be no stress here. So this part you will find there is almost no stress. So it's like all the water coming along a channel and flowing through this hole into the gusset plate, okay, or into the sink. So what we find is, when we go on increasing the load, the net sections here might govern, or sections here might govern. And then what happens is, we find that when this connected leg reaches yield or ultimate, the outstanding leg has not reached ultimate. So what we were doing for this plate, we can't apply in this case. That is, we are assuming that the entire cross section reaches ultimate stress, which we can't do here. So when the connected leg is reached ultimate, the other part is only in somewhere plus or minus the yield stress. So that is called shear lag. The other way of understanding this is, imagine this angle to be made up like, you just keep your fingers like that, your palm flat. So if you pull the top finger, you don't experience a force in the other fingers, right? So how does this force which I pull in the top edge come down to this bolt? That is because there is a shear connection between these different strips. Okay, so the top strip cannot be pulled out. It's a single same angle. It is all connected with each other. So each strip is connected, and it transfers the shear force through the top strip to the next strip, and so on, and finally it comes to the connected leg. So this is how the shear lag occurs, and this shear lag will depend on many of the factors like the connection length and so on. And as such, we have to account for all that if you want to calculate the exact strength of the angle. Okay. So with that background, now we look at how the code is giving, what are the clauses that are given in the code for design of tension members. It generally defines tension members. And 6.2 talks about design strength due to yielding of cross section. 6.3 talks about design strength due to rupture of critical section. This is applicable only when there are holes in the section to connect, for connection, for putting bolts or rivets. And then there is another failure mode, which is called design strength due to block shear. This can occur either with welded or with bolted, generally with bolted. So we'll see what are those failure modes. Okay. So in the limit state code, the general equation that we will adopt for checking is the factored load, that is load factor into the usual service load, that is called the factored load T, should be less than the design strength TD. Okay. So for design strength due to yielding of gross section, we give the suffix D for design and G for gross. So design strength in tension due to yielding of gross section is given by the yield stress by gamma m naught. So even though the equation is written, please note that it should, as soon as you find Fy, you attach gamma m naught below that. So you should read it as Fy by gamma m naught into A gross, the gross area, okay, where gamma m naught is 1.1. So that is the load at which the plate will yield or the member will yield and it will become very long. So that is defined as a failure stress. So even though physically it is not failing, that is the point at which failure would have occurred, okay, or the structure will not be usable after that. Then design strength due to rupture of critical or net section is TDN, is given by actually fu by gamma m1, that is gamma m1 accounts for the uncertainty in fu, into area, net area, a net, and another factor 0.9 is put because this will be a sudden rupture, unlike yielding which will be gradual, this rupture will be so sudden. So to make sure that it is avoided, generally another factor 0.9 is put, and gamma m1 is 1.25, and a net is given by this formula which we just saw for plates with multiple holes. Same formula for threaded rods. Threaded rods, what we do is we take a rod of diameter D and we cut the threads in that rod for putting the nut. So the actual diameter or the area at the root of the threads is D, diameter is D root, and area will be A root or A net. Okay. So this A net is typically about 0.8 times the A gross for threaded rods or bolts, etc. And the code says you should use this formula for calculating the design strength of such threaded rods. Okay. Now coming to single angles, as we saw, due to shear lag, the strength is less. So what we have to do is the code gives you a formula. Again, it's an empirical formula. The TDN, that is the design tensile strength due to net section rupture, is given by ANC, that is the net area of the connected leg, into 0.9 fu by gamma m1 plus beta times a gross into fy by gamma m0. That is, the connected leg is at fu by gamma m1. The gross, that is outstanding leg, will be at fy by gamma m0, somewhere beta times fy by gamma m0. Okay. So what is that beta is now again explained in a formula. That beta depends on the distance of the extreme fiber from the bolt that is connected in the cross section. Okay, this is a cross section shown, or this is a welded cross section where this is a weld, and the distance of the extreme fiber is given by W. So it is a function of W by T, where T is the thickness of the plate, and BS is the extreme fiber distance, that is in this case is W plus W1. W is the leg size, and here it is this much, it is only W, and W by T, leg size by thickness, and 0.076 you have to multiply, fu by fy, you do all this, you find out beta. If your beta comes less than 0.7, you take it as 0.7, and if your beta comes more than 1.4, you keep it as 1.4. So the limits are also given in the code. So with that limit of beta, we can work out the net section rupture. So it looks little complicated, especially for design. So what we can do is we can take typically beta as, let's say, 1 or something, and then we can quickly calculate this and find out what is the area required to resist the given load. Okay. So alternatively, the code gives a simplified equation which is alpha times a net into fu by gamma on m1, where it says you take alpha as 0.6 for 1 or 2 bolts, 0.7 for 3 bolts, and 0.8 for 4 or more bolts. That is, the length of the connection will be very long. So alpha will come out as around 0.8. So this we can use for first design, and then we can check. If we want more accurate check, we will go back to this equation. Otherwise, we will stop. We can code allows us to stop with this single equation itself. Okay. So we can do this as a simpler method. So we will find that in the code always there is a very accurate method given. There's also a simpler method given. And as far as possible, you can try with the simpler method. When there is economy is an issue, you can go for the more accurate method. Okay. So then the last failure mode, that is something called block shear. Now block shear was not there in the old code because the old code was essentially assuming use of low strength rivets. But nowadays, as high strength bolts, etc., are very easily available. So instead of like 6 bolts, I might manage with 2 bolts and so on. And if I use a mild steel plate with very high strength bolts, or if I put very low pitch and end distances, if I give, then what happens is when we pull, a part of the plate breaks as a block, and then the rest of it comes out. So this is called block shear. And for checking this block shear, the code gives two equations and it says that the smaller of these two will be the strength governed by, as governed by block shear. So for block shear, if I pull this plate like this, my section 1, 2 and 3, 4, these will go in shear, right? So for shear we use the suffix V, and for net area we use N, for grass area we use G, okay? And for 2, 3, section will go in tension, that is if I am pulling this across this cross section, there will be a tensile stress. So for that we use the suffix T, okay? So this formula is not difficult to remember, or it's not difficult to memorize, because what we are thinking is, once we write this 1, 2, 3, 4 section, for 1, 2 and 3, 4, it is in shear AV, and first we take grass section for this, that means we don't deduct for the bolt holes. We take the full section, that is length from this point to the center of this hole, that will be into thickness, will give me AVG into FY by gamma M naught. Gamma M naught is uncertainty in FY, but we need to put root 3 because now it is in shear, this section is in shear. So as per 1 Mises criteria, we put root 3 here. So that is how we get this strength of these two sections, plus the third section 2, 3, that is the, since we use grass here, we have to use net here, okay. So ATN into 0.9 FU by gamma M1, that is the second term. For the second equation, we use, instead of grass, we are going to use the net section here. So AVN into 0.9 FU by root 3 gamma M1. So this, 1, 2, 3, 4 remains in shear even though it is reaching now FU, okay. So it is FU by root 3 gamma M1 plus ATG, that is the grass section for 2, 3 in tension, into FY by gamma M1. So it is very easy, you don't even need the code to write this formula, okay. So you just check with these two formulas and you will find that that is the strength as governed by block shear. So your tensile strength of the member is the smallest of the yielding of the grass section, rupture of the net section and block shear failure. All the three equations you calculate, whichever is the smaller, that is the governing strength or the design strength of the member, okay. Now block shear, another, as I told you, will not be an issue under, if you are using ordinary bolts, that is grade 4.6 bolts or what are called black bolts. If you are using high strength bolts in mild steel plates, then only block shear will be an issue. Or if you are using very small end distance and pitch, then block shear will be an issue. So if you put adequate pitch and gauge distance, connection will become little larger, but block shear will not be an issue. So by experience, we will know when to check for this and when not to check for this. But if you are not sure, you better check and make sure it doesn't happen, govern. Now, talking of efficiency, the maximum strength that a member can take is basically AGFY by gamma M naught. So we keep that at the denominator. If the design is governed by yielding of the grass section, then TD will be same as denominator. So efficiency will become 1, that is 100%. Okay. If TD is governed by block shear or net section failure, then efficiency will be less than 1. So our aim should be to try and achieve 100% efficiency. And in some rare cases, we might accept a slightly lower efficiency, but we should try and make sure that we design efficient connections for tension members. Anyway, that we will see later on in the course. Okay. So the design steps are basically you calculate the net area required as the factored tension divided by Fu by gamma M1, the grass area required as this, then assume some connection and then choose a trial section based on these two areas. So once you provide that area, you analyze with those three equations and verify that the structure is safe. There is another requirement, that is the stiffness requirement for members. Some of these members like brazings, as I told you, might go under compression rarely. So if there is a chance of compression coming on the member, you have to limit the slenderness to 250. If it is not designed for compression, then you can go up to 350. And if the members are going to be only under tension, then you are allowed to use a slenderness of 400, so that the member will be more or less straight even during handling. Okay, so that is why some limits are given in the code. So this is the summary. Tension members are basically efficient load carrying members. Efficiency may reduce due to bolt holes, shear lag in angles connected by one leg and block shear when the connections are very small. Okay, so this completes the second presentation. Now I think we are open for questions. There's another question regarding the previous presentation that says, which is the critical combination of loads to be considered for serviceability condition. So in design, we don't define the critical combination a priori, because different structures or different members will have different magnitudes of dead loads, live loads, etc. So we have to check for all those combinations with unit load factors, that is the and then show that the deflections are under limit, under dead load plus leading live load plus accompanying live load, and if required, dead load plus these two live loads plus wind load or earthquake load, whatever. Okay, so corresponding deflection we have to verify. Okay, so we will proceed with the next presentation, that is design of compression members. Okay, now contents are like this. First we'll have a introduction, and then we'll look at what is called as elastic buckling of an ideal column, then strength curve for an ideal column, then strength of practical column. So again, this presentation will tell you why we can't use simple theory like the Euler's theory for calculating and designing a compression member. Okay, there are, what is the problem in using a simple theory like Euler's theory for design of compression member? So we find that practical members have several issues, and so we need to go for testing. And after repeated testing or analysis and all, we develop a data bank. We draw those probability curves that we saw in a limit state method, and based on that we decide how we will design this members. Okay, so then we will look at concept of effective lengths for different end conditions of the compression members. Then we have to look at one more type of buckling, which is called torsional buckling, and that will help us to understand what is called torsional flexural buckling or flexural torsional buckling. This occurs in angle members which are under compression and they are loaded through one leg, and then conclusions. Okay, so let's just go ahead. There's one more issue which is called related to local buckling, also we need to look at, but that we'll discuss in the next session. So let's look at compression members. Compression members, you know, are traditionally called short or long. Ideal words would be squash, stocky or slender, because the length alone doesn't matter. It's the slenderness ratio, which is length divided by the radius of gyration, which matters. So if the member is short, basically we say a member is short when its failure is governed by crushing. Okay, so they apply compression, the metal will yield in compression, and thereby it will squash. So it's also called a squash load, that is we realize that it will get squashed. Okay, like a tomato, if you keep a tomato and press it on the table, it gets squashed. Okay, and you get tomato squash. Okay, so if it is the member is long, like your refill of your pen, ball pen, then as you press it buckles, right? So that is called buckling of a member, and then it is called as a long member. Okay, so now these are not just arbitrary terms. We have to be able to predict when a member, at what length it will, up to what length it will squash, and after which it will buckle. Okay, so we'll see how to do that. But generally we find that this buckling as an issue comes up in more in steel rather than in reinforced concrete or other members. In concrete also it can buckle, provided the lengths are large, but in steel often the lengths are large, and so the members are more susceptible to buckling. So one probably reason for this is, if you take concrete, it is only 25, M25 has 25 MPa strength, whereas even the common mild steel has 250 MPa strength. So I need only 1/10 of the cross-sectional area to take the same load. Okay, so as I reduce the cross-sectional area, my radius of gyration also reduces. I can try to increase the R or I value by making it like a hollow tube, etc. But then even with that, my L by R goes up, and then the member becomes a long member and fails by buckling. Okay, so that is why in steel we have to look at buckling. And buckling we know is well studied by the Euler's theory of elastic buckling, where several assumptions have to be made. First assumption is the material of the member or the strut. There are different words used. You call it a column, you call it a compression member, you call it a strut, etc. So whatever it is that is which you, the member under compression has to be homogeneous and linearly elastic. Linearly elastic means it should have a proportionality constant, which is Young's modulus E. Okay. Then the member has no imperfection. That means it is perfectly straight. Okay. Then there is no eccentricity of loading. That is, the load is exactly concentric to the cross section of the member, and there are no residual stresses. I'll explain what are residual stresses later on. Okay. So under these conditions, we can assume a deflected shape for the member, and we do what is called as a buckling analysis. So once I assume a deflected shape which is compatible with the end conditions. So let's say the top and bottom of this member are pinned, that is hinged. So you can have rotation, but you can't have deflection. Okay. So I am assuming a half sine curve as a possible deflected shape, and then I find that the external action, that is P into this at any point y, distance x. I set up an x axis and a y axis. So my deflection is y at a distance x. So P into y is my bending moment, and divided by EI, it gives me the P into y gives me the bending moment, and EI d2y by dx square is my moment of resistance of the cross section. So equating the external moment to the moment of resistance, I get a governing differential equation of this type, which is the d square y by dx square plus the p by EI into y equal to 0. And now my aim is to solve this and find the y. And once I find the y, there will be a corresponding associated p critical value. Okay. So this is a second order ordinary differential equation. And what Euler found was this has discrete solutions. Okay. So of the type n square pi square EI by lambda square, where lambda is L by R and so on. So, but the lowest value normally governs the design. So n is 1. So if n is 1, the lowest value of the critical load comes out as pi square EI by lambda square, where lambda is defined as this thing, that is L by R bracket square. Okay. So the stress, corresponding stress, will be P critical by A, which is pi square EI by A lambda square. So I by A is basically this should have been L square. So I by A becomes your R square, that is R radius of gyration is defined as root of I by A. Once I substitute that, I will get sigma critical as pi square E by lambda square. Okay. So we find that we can solve this equation and we get the critical stress or the critical load, okay, at which this column will buckle. Now that if you plot as a function of lambda, that is I plot lambda on the x axis and the stress sigma CR or the and the y axis, I will get a rectangular hyperbola like thing, which is this curve B1CP, okay, this curve. But real structures, as we go on reducing lambda, it shows, this seems to show that this will tend to infinity, right? The stress can go to infinity, but real structures have a finite stress value, that is their stress cannot go beyond the yield stress. Okay, so we should cut this here, and we say that that part of the curve which is above this is not valid or not practicable. So we have a failure curve or a column strength curve for an ideal strut in this form of one straight line at Fy and another curve, which is this curve, which is for which the equation is pi square E by lambda square. Okay, so that is the equation. So we have a critical lambda C value, which is called a critical slenderness ratio. So if the slenderness is more than that, it will fail at the corresponding stress by buckling. If the slenderness is less than this, it will reach yield stress and then it may fail by buckling. So it will first of all reach the yield stress, and this load is called a squash load. Okay, Fy into A will be the squash load. So this is how we get a column strength curve for an ideal strut, and this is in a dimensional form, although lambda is still a non-dimensional quantity. But if you change the yield strength, let's say I increase my yield strength from 250 to 350, then instead of drawing the line here, I'll draw the line here. Okay, but this curve will remain same for a higher strength steel also, because E remains the same. So my lambda C will actually reduce; it will come down. Okay, So we find that as they increase the strength of the steel more and more, the critical slenderness ratio will come down, and what was failing by yielding will start failing by buckling. So in that sense, very high strength steel may not be of much use to us as a compression member. Okay. Now, to have a single curve for various grades of steel, what we are doing is we are dividing the y-axis, which was the failure stress, by Fy. So here, which was Fy, it will become 1, and x-axis we are going to divide by lambda c. Okay, so this lambda now will be divided by lambda c. So this point will become 1, and we'll get a what is called as a strength curve in a non-dimensionalized form, and that lambda bar, which is basically lambda by lambda c, will be can also be denoted as Fy by square root of Fy by sigma critical. Okay, so that is how we get a single curve for any grade of steel. We can use this. Then now, unfortunately, we can't use this curve for design. Why? Because practical columns, when you test, they fail at strength lower than what is predicted by this curve. So it becomes a big problem. So if you use this curve, you'll get unsafe designs. Your calculation will show that your column is going to fail at, let's say, 100 kilonewton, but actually at 88 itself it will fail. So it is not possible for us to use this. So we need to understand why this is happening, right? Why practical columns fail at lower strength than what is predicted by Euler's theory. So factors affecting strength of real columns or practical columns. Number one is effect of initial out of straightness. Practical columns, they are actually made of rolled steel sections, so they are never perfectly straight. They always have a slight bow, and there are tolerances defined. Like we say that the bow should not be more than 1/1000th of the length of the member, and so on. So if that is the case, we'll accept that, but that will still have a lesser strength than what is predicted by Euler's theory. Okay. Then effect of eccentricity of applied load. We will try to apply the load, even in a lab, we try to apply the load exactly at the CG of the section, but there will always be some eccentricity due to reasons beyond our control. In practical columns, we apply the load through the beam, which is connected at the face of the column, right? So there will be a significant eccentricity, but still we want to design the column as a actually loaded member, as long as there is no movement transferred from the beam to the column. Okay, so we are going to consider as an actually loaded column, but there will be an eccentricity. Then there will be what are called residual stresses. Let's look at this. What is done is, this is the flange, this is the web, and this is the other flange. So this is basically an I section. This I section is now formed from a block of steel. It is heated to high temperature. It is passed through rollers, successive rollers, right? So it is like these rollers apply pressure. They roll it into this shape, okay? And the section is in a very hot condition. Again, if it cools, I will again heat it up, and again I'll pass through a next set of rollers until I get the required shape of my cross section. So what happens is, after I get that shape, I allow it to cool in the air. So at that point, what happens is, these edges, which are having more perimeter and less area, they cool faster. Similarly, the middle part of the web will cool faster. Okay, so these members are cooling and contracting in length, and then the flange web junction will finally try to cool. So when it tries to cool, these edges are already cooled, so they don't allow it to cool further. Okay, so what will happen is, there will be a tensile stress, residual stress in that place, and there will be a compressive residual stress in the other place. That is, this flange web junction is now trying to cool and reduce in length, so it tries to pull the other edges down, but the other edges are pushing it up. Okay, so you have compression at these locations and you have tension here. Similarly, along the depth of the web, you have tension here and compression at the middle of the web. So these residual stresses are set of self-balancing stresses. That is, if I integrate the stress into each elemental area, I will get finally zero, because there's no externally applied load on the section. Okay, so they cancel out each other, but then they are there. So now, on top of this, when I apply a compression stress, P by A will be my average compressive stress, let's say. So that I apply, and I find that if this residual stress is, let's say, 0.3 Fy, so if I apply the remaining 0.7 Fy itself, this will reach yield. Okay, so So what I'm assuming is that up to Fy it should not yield, but actually it is yielding earlier because there is a residual stress present there. Okay, so this kind of disturbs the stress distribution. So that effect is there. Then there is an effect of strain hardening and the absence of clearly defined yield point, especially with high strength steel. Okay, then actually in reality all these are there to varying proportions. So some columns may have more out of straightness but less residual stress depending on the cross section and so on and so forth. So now all this will affect the final strength of those columns. Now so we have to understand now how to tackle all this together. Okay, so effect of all features, all these features taken together is reflected in the data from collapse tests in the lab, and we find that the test data comes like this. So for a particular L by R, I find one column collapse little early, one column collapse little late or at a higher strength and so on. Probably this column had a more adverse combination of all these features, and this column had at least one was better than the other and so on. Okay, so now what we want to do is for design we want a lower bound curve for all these tests. At the same time we don't want to get a very low curve also, because then economy will be affected. So we want a curve which will fit to this lower bound and as closely as possible. Okay, so that is what we are trying to find out. And so this has been going on for actually for more than 50-60 years, and now finally they have come to what is called as multiple curves. So they know if you take an I section and if it buckles about YY axis, the weak axis, then what is the effect of all these features and what lower bound curve we should use for that buckling. Okay, so that they have come up with, and now we use what are called multiple column curves for design. Okay, so with that background we will now come to the actual codal provisions on the design of compression members. These are the provisions of section 7 of the code. The design strength is given, then effective lengths are defined, then some design details are given, then column bases, although they are not part of compression members, they are covered under this section, and then angle compression members. Okay, so we'll just go ahead. Then built up columns in terms of lazed and battened columns are also covered in the code. Coming back, this lower bound curve is called the design curve. This is our Euler curve, and after that it is not valid, and these are the test data which are in between. Okay, so now when we want to design a compression member, our idea should be for a given area we should try and get as much of the radius of gyration as possible, so that L by R will come down, the design strength will go up, and we will get a more efficient design of the compression member. Okay, but at the same time we also have this requirement of being able to connect the member to other members, right? So in, for example, a truss, I might use an angle as a compression member because it's easy to connect. Okay, or a single angle or a double angle or a T section and so on, or a channel section, so on, I'll try to use. But many of these sections have very weak or very small radius of gyration about a particular axis. Okay, for example, with an angle, there's something called a VV axis which is cutting across like this. So RVV is the minimum value for an angle. Okay, so similarly for a channel, this will be called as the ZZ axis, where the two flanges are parallel to the ZZ axis and the web is parallel to the YY axis. So RYY will become very small. Okay, so if I'm not satisfied with this, I have to go for a built up section or whatever. I can go for hollow tubes, like circular hollow sections or rectangular hollow sections, but problem with them is we can't connect them very easily. Okay, we can't put bolts, sometimes we have to put diaphragms, otherwise we can't connect them with welds also. So so instead of hollow tubes, what is preferred is built up sections like this are preferred. That is, we keep two angles facing each other or two angles facing back to back, and then we lace or batten them together. Okay, we'll tie them together to get a built up section. So we can also add extra plates to I sections and so on. We can build our own I section with three plates and etc. So idea here is the section should be easy to make, because lacing, battening also will cost you time and effort. So it should be easy to make, it should be easy to connect, and it should give maximum R value for minimum cross sectional area. Okay, Then once we do that, the design compressive strength is given by PD, is actually AE, effective area into FCD. Okay, so here FCD is defined as the design compressive stress. You have to read it backwards. It's D for design, C for compressive, and F for stress. C and D are suffixes. Is given by Fy by gamma m naught divided by an expression which is having phi and lambda, where phi is again expressed in terms of alpha and lambda. So basically, we have only two unknowns, alpha and lambda. If we know alpha and lambda, we can calculate phi. Once we calculate phi, we can put it here, and then we will get 1 upon this entire thing is also denoted by a Greek letter chi. So chi into Fy by gamma m naught, and chi becomes also our efficiency factor. If chi is 1, that means your column is short, and it FCD is nothing but Fy by gamma m naught. So it's failing by crushing of the section. Okay. So generally chi will be around 0.6 or 0.7 of that order for columns. It can even be much lower for industrial columns. Okay. So now how to calculate lambda and alpha? Okay. Lambda is the non-dimensionalized effective slenderness, that is the lambda by lambda c, as the original KL by R divided by lambda c, that is pi square e by L by R bracket square, right? So that is the value. So Fy by root of Fy by FCC, that is FCC is again given by this expression. Okay, so that is our lambda, which is in the non-dimensionalized form, and alpha is an imperfection factor, is defined in table 7, and chi is the stress reduction factor given in table 8. FCDs are also given in tables if you don't want to calculate, but it is not very difficult to calculate. Once I know KL by R, I can calculate this, and I can put it, pick up the correct alpha, put here, calculate phi, I can calculate chi, and then I get FCD. Okay, so that can also be done. So now the code gives you what are called multiple column curves for design. The curves are called A, B, C, D. Depending on the axis about which a particular section is buckling, we have to choose the correct curve. Once we choose the correct curve, it's called a buckling class, and for that the imperfection factor alpha is defined. Okay, so the larger the alpha, the more imperfect your column, and that means you'll get lower strength compared to the other curves. Okay, so which curve to use when is given in this table, that is table 10, where the cross sections are defined. And the limits are also defined, like thickness grade less than 40 and all that, and then the buckling axis is defined. So let's take a rolled I section. If it is going to buckle about ZZ, I have to use curve A. If I am checking for buckling about YY, I have to use curve B. Why this is happening? Because the imperfection about YY will be generally larger. That is, it will not be perfectly straight in the YY direction rather than compared with the ZZ direction. Similarly, if I take a welded I section, I'm going to weld them. So welding produces lot of residual stresses. Okay. So what will happen is, if residual stresses are high, I will have to use a lower curve. Lower curve. So you can see, compared with a rolled I section buckling about ZZ, a welded I section buckling about ZZ, A curve has become B curve. Okay. Or compared with the YY axis buckling, where I was using B curve for a rolled section, I'll have to be using a C curve, because residual stresses are high for a welded section. So that is how this has been brought in. So indirectly, we are accounting for imperfections, residual stresses, initial out of straightness, everything by using these empirical curves. Okay, and this is the equation for those empirical curves. If you put alpha, and if you plot FCD versus this non-dimensionalized lambda, these are the curves that you are going to see. You can plot it quickly in an Excel sheet also. Proceeding further, so that is, we understand that we did this, we'll just go back a little bit. We did this analysis for, let's say, hinge column. We got a particular critical stress for buckling. Now, what if the column is fixed or fixed free, whatever, okay, other end conditions. So we use what is called as the concept of effective length, which you might already be knowing because you learn it in strength of materials. So if it is at one end, if it is restrained means fixed, and at the other end it is free, it's like a cantilever, so then the effective length is 2. Okay, Don't worry which end is fixed, it doesn't matter. One end is fixed, one end is free. It can be the other way also. That is, left end can be free, free, right end can be fixed, fixed. Okay. Then also the effective length will be 2. Okay. So similarly for other end conditions, the factors are given. Now these factors are slightly different from the theoretical values. For example, for a fixed fixed condition, we get a theoretical value of 1 by root 2, L by root 2. 1 by root 2 is about 0.707. But this is giving 0.65. Why? Because you can never have perfect fixity. Okay. In fact, in real columns, you can even never have perfect hinge, because we normally don't make a single pin and make a hinge for real I section columns. Okay. So these are taking care of the imperfect nature of the actual connections, but we still idealize them as free or restrained or whatever, that is hinged, free or fixed, whatever, for our convenience. So what we are telling is ideal situation, but practical columns will have some deviation from the ideal situation. So those effective lengths are again empirical. Now we come to design of column bases. There can be two types of column bases. If my column is going to be only under compression, then I don't really need to connect it to the base. I can just keep it on a base plate. Okay, the base plate is still required because this column is now going to be kept on some other material. It could be concrete, it could be sand, or it could be something else, rock or whatever, which will have a less capacity strength compared to the steel that we are using. Okay, so I am bringing the load in the through the column with very high stress, and now this stress has to be distributed over a larger area because the material below, which is called a subgrade, cannot take that kind of stress. Okay, so what we are trying to do is we are trying to distribute the stress over a larger area. Okay. Now again, theoretically, people think that if you put a larger and larger base plate, then the stress will come get smaller and smaller, and the design may come out as safe. But that is again not true, because what happens is when you put a column on the plate will have sort of biaxial bending. Okay, and some part of the plate will lift up, and that will not be available for transferring the load. So the load which is coming through this column cannot reach the farthest end of the plate. Okay, so the code tells you that if you are using a single plate as a base for the column, then you have to make sure that your thickness of the plate satisfies this equation. Okay, what is this equation? The if I have an I section, let's say like this, I draw a dashed rectangle around that, and the largest projection is called A. This B again has moved, the other projection, smaller projection, is called small b. So these are the projections of the plate from the corner of the I section, and if those are A and B, and if W is the modulus of subgrade reaction, that is the load that the subgrade can take. You know that if you are using concrete, what is the bearing stress that concrete can take? Okay, or if it is the soil, what is the bearing capacity that the soil will take? So that is W. So if that is the case, then the thickness of this plate should be at least greater than the value given by this formula. Okay, then only the column base will be able to distribute the stress over that entire area. Okay, otherwise it will distribute over a smaller area. For an I section, we can also use instead of this rectangle, we can also use this another shape, wherein this distance C, which is the projection, largest projection around the I section, can be calculated by this formula. Okay, so instead of A and B, this formula, we can also use C, and an alternative formula is given. So that can be used. Okay, so that is for a column base. Now steps in the design of actually loaded columns. So we go back, let's say, and we want to design a column to carry a certain PD. Okay, so now what is the area required? That will depend on an FCD. So unless I choose a section, I can't actually calculate these properties, right? L by R, etc. I can't calculate, and area of section also I will not know. So it's a trial and error design process. So we can break the trial at some point. So easiest way is, let's say we assume the FCD to be 150 MPa. Okay, as a per mile steel. If it's a slightly higher strength steel, I might use 160 or 170, whatever. I assume that as 150 MPa. So A required will be the factored load. Always we limit said we talk in terms of the factored load, P divided by 150 MPa, that is the area required. Then I go to the steel table, I find a section, I section or channel section, which has that required area. It need not be exactly matching or greater or smaller, but somewhere nearby I find a section, and I should ensure that the section is semi-compact. This we'll see later. This is for avoiding local buckling. We will see this section classification later on. But apart from this, skipping that step, now we arrive at the effective length of the column by based on the end conditions that we have. Then L by R will give me the slenderness ratio. For that lambda value, we calculate the FCD value for both major and minor axis. Okay, and you should realize that a column can have different effective length along the two axes. Okay, for ZZ it may be fixed, but for YY it may be hinged. So anything is any combinations are possible. So we have to calculate for both the axes what are the capacities, and the smaller of the two will govern the design. Okay, so it's possible that I may have a column which is connected at from bottom to top, hinged at the bottom and the top above the ZZ axis, but it has an extra lateral support at the mid height at for the YY axis. So then the effective length for YY axis will be reduced to half. Okay, and even though RYY is less than RZZ, maybe L by RZZ will govern. Okay, L effective ZZ by RZZ may govern. So now once we do that, we calculate the design compressive strength. If P is less than PD, the design strength, then the column is safe or the section design is safe. Otherwise, we have to go back and repeat with a higher section. Okay. So with one trial or two trial, if P is very much less than PD, the column is safe. Okay, but it may not be economical. Okay, it is you have over designed the section. So I would say P at least should be between 60% to 100% of PD. Okay, then it's a economical and safe design. Okay, so P should not be less than 0.6 times PD. Then it is an uneconomical design. So you can repeat the design one more time and get a more economical section. Okay. Now, this other issue has been tackled in the code, that is angle struts. Angle struts are again compression members which are again generally connected by one leg. So the compression comes on the let's see if there is a figure here. No, it's not there. So the compression comes at the center of one of the legs. Okay, and as a consequence, what happens is the angle tends to not only buckle, it also twists in the cross section. That is, it has flexural torsional buckling. Okay, so to take care of this flexural torsional buckling, the code gives you a simple method wherein if it was only flexural buckling, L by RVV would have governed, that is lambda VV would have governed the design. But now, because of the tendency of the angle to twist due to one leg is connected, the other leg is not outstanding, so the angle twists and it may fail at either a lower value than pure flexural buckling or a higher value than flexural buckling. That depends on the end conditions again. So we calculate an effective slenderness ratio lambda E using empirical constant K1, K2, K3 and lambda VV and lambda phi, where lambda VV is nothing but KL by RVV divided by this factor. In the code, this is wrongly printed as capital E. So you need to correct that code. This is epsilon, which is a factor for the yield stress ratio, that is root of 250 by Fy. So if you use, as I said, higher strength steel, epsilon will reduce. It will become less than 1. For normal mild steel, it will be 1. So that comes here, and then you get lambda VV. Lambda phi is the two legs of the angle B1 and B2 added divided by 2t and divided by this factor again. So that is lambda phi. So we calculate lambda VV, lambda phi, and substitute here. K1, K2, K3 we have to go and get from a table. Okay. So in the table, what is given is the number of bolts at each end of the connection. If it is one bolt, then it is a perfect hinge. Okay, if it is more than one bolt, it is not a hinge. Even weld will fall in this category. If you have welded the angle at either end, we are assuming that both ends are connections are similar. So here welding also is equal to having more than one bolt. Okay, so that is more than one bolt. And then the other issue is the fixity of the gusset plate. Now I am connecting this angle, let's say, to the gusset plate, whether the gusset plate will bend out of its plane, because plates are very flexible out of their plane. So that fixity has to be determined. So typically I will say, if your gusset plate is of same thickness or less than the thickness of the angle, then you assume as hinged. Otherwise you can assume as fixed. Okay. So if the gusset plate is thicker than the angle, you can assume it as fixed. Or instead of gusset plate, sometimes we may connect it to another member or another section. Let's say I may connect it to the web of a channel. So in that case, if the web of a channel, I can assume as fixed, because it has flanges on both sides. Okay. So I can assume as fixed. So depending on the gusset or connecting member fixity and the number of bolts, I will choose K1, K2, K3. Okay, and substitute here, and I'll get lambda E. Then I have to, once I get lambda E, it is as if it's a concentrically loaded angle with lambda equal to lambda E. So then I go back and calculate FCD corresponding, and then FCD into area of that angle will give me PD, and I'll check whether my angle is safe or not. So that is the procedure to verify. Now, when you want to design an angle, you sometimes get confused. What happens is, it's a long procedure. So in, especially in exam, you want to design it in a short time. You take an angle, you check all this, you calculate K1, K2, K3, everything you put, and then your angle is coming out as unsafe. So again, you have to take another angle, right? So to shorten this procedure, trial and error procedure, what you can do is, for the first trial, you take lambda E same as lambda VV. That means you don't worry about all this K1, K2 or gusset fixity and all. You just directly assume lambda E as lambda VV. Check whether your angle is coming out safe. Only if it is safe, then you go back and show that this equation also, it is safe. Okay. So that is how you complete the design. So you do as if you are doing an actually loaded member. You calculate, assume let's say FCD as 150, or for angles you can assume it around 120 MPa. For 120 MPa, what is the A required, and then choose an angle which has A just more than that A required, and then for that you calculate lambda VV and check FCD, and if it comes safe, then you do this lengthy calculation and show. Okay, so that is how you can show that design single angle. For laced and batten columns, the design procedures are quite easy to understand, so I'm not going to cover them in detail. Okay, only thing is, this is called a single lacing and this is called a double lacing, this is called battening. So we put a batten plate or whatever. What we try to do is, the code says you try to assume that, let's say we separate two sections, channels by a distance. So this will be my ZZ axis, and IZZ will be 2 times IZZ of one channel, right? So this channel has some IZ small ZZ, this also has I small ZZ. If you add the two, you'll get I capital ZZ. Similarly, this channel have IYY about its CG axis into AY square. That is, now we are trying to calculate IYY about the capital YY axis for the combined section. So we IYY plus A into this distance square between this CG of this channel and the YY, capital YY axis, that will give you the total axis. So we have to make sure that IYY is almost equal to IZZ, and that is the design we follow. Okay. And once we do that, the effective slenderness ratio has to be further increased by 5% for a laced column and 10% for a batten column to account for what are called shear deformation effects. So when this combined section is trying to buckle, the there will be a relative motion between this angle, this channel, and this channel. Okay, that will, they will, in the length direction, there will be a shear deformation effect which will happen because of the flexibility of the lacing that is holding the two sections together. To account for that, we have to increase the slenderness ratio by 5% and 10% for laced and batten columns. And so that completes compression member design. Now we'll have a question and answer session. Okay, I'll start from the bottommost question. Can block shear effect occur in eccentric tensile members? Yeah, it can occur in eccentric tension members also. So we need to check that the same way as we check for a concentric tension member. Okay. And what is the next question? So this is, I've answered. I need to take this. Then what is the basic idea behind the beta formula in the calculation of rupture strength in single angles? So the basic idea behind the beta formula is the effect of shear lag. So if you have a long connection, then the effect of shear lag will reduce. Okay, or if you are able to connect both the legs by some means, like using a lug angle or whatever, then you can design it as a concentrically loaded angle. Okay, so that is both legs connected. So you calculate the net section as usual and do the design. But if you are having a projecting leg which is not connected, then there is a shear lag, and I think I've explained that leg will have less stress than the connected leg. Okay, so that is the answer for that beta value. Then how radius of gyration and effective length govern selection of a trial section for compression member? The trial section, as I said, either you can choose based on L by R, or you can choose based on FCD. Okay, so some people assume a value for L by R and then choose a trial section, or some people, I think a better method would be you assume FCD itself as 150 MPa for an I section. If it is a built up section, you can even assume 170 MPa. If it is an angle section, you assume around 120-130 MPa, and then you calculate the A required, P by this value. For corresponding this stress, you'll get a required area. So P by A required will give you the P by this stress will give you the A required. Then you go to the steel table, and depending on the type of section you want, you select I section or a channel section or whatever, and then once you have the section, you can calculate its exact R value, and based on the end conditions, you will get the KL. That is, K is the effective length factor. KL divided by R will give you the KL by R, and then divide by that pi squared E by lambda square will give you the FCD value, I mean lambda bar, that is non-dimensional slenderness value, and based on that you calculate FCD and verify that it is safe. And is it possible to make tension members by using welded connection? Of course, it is possible to make tension members by using welded connections. Okay, only if it is an angle tension member, there also shear lag has to be taken care of. Okay, this says, in my point of view, block shear occurs only when the load is direct. Eccentrical loading doesn't create block shear failure. Normally we connect these plates by what you call bolts or rivets. So if that is the case, there will be a shear in those bolts, okay, shear transfer. So eccentric loading might give some bending moment also. So in that case, block shear may not be governing, because the different bolts will have different stresses. So you may not have to check for block shear. You check the extreme bolt which is having maximum stress. But again, these are qualitative, you know, like you could have more direct shear and very little eccentricity, in which case block shear might govern. So you must check for block shear also under the direct component of the shear. Okay, so that one, and you don't have to include the eccentricity effects in checking when you are checking for block shear, that we can tell. Okay, but then it will be a complicated way of checking it. Okay, there's one more question. How to improve the strength of member without providing having shear lag? I believe it says providing, but I think it is how to improve the strength of a member. So for example, if we have a channel section, most of our material is in the two flanges. So if we can connect the two flanges of the tension member channel section, then we will get we will be avoiding shear lag, and we will get a better design. Okay, but if we connect only the web, then we'll have shear lag, block shear, all these problems will come. So we have to understand how the section is, how the stress is flowing. If we are able to take that force stress flow directly by the through the connection, then we will not have shear lag, etc. Okay. Yeah, of course we can improve the strength by lug angle. Once you lug angles are small pieces of angles which are connected to the outstanding leg. They collect the stress from the outstanding leg into the lug angle and transfer it to the gusset plate. Okay, so that way the length of the connection can also be improved, and it will improve the strength of the member also. One doubt about the lapping of steel when we are going to continue the structure from one floor to another. I think I'll cover this when we talk about connections. It's called splicing. So when we talk about splices or connections, I'll answer this question. Okay, what is buckling in frames? New question has come. Basically, frame members, again, the columns or even the beams, we can consider as individual members, and we can idealize the end conditions. Okay, if the frame is free to sway, that is move in the lateral direction, then we will say the top is free to move in the lateral direction, but the girder is giving a restraint so that it can't rotate easily. So it will have that end condition that is free to move but cannot rotate, and the bottom may be hinged or fixed or whatever. So that way we can design individual members. Or in the appendix of the code, there is a again nomograms are given for calculating effective length of a member in a frame. So the end conditions will be dictated by the stiffness of the members which are framing into that joint. So based on their stiffness, we might have larger or smaller effective length. Okay, so your effective length can even exceed the length of the member. Like for example, in cantilever, K factor is 2, right? So it can even become 3 for a multi-storied frame, which can sway the lateral direction, and that factor we have to calculate, and then we'll get the KL value. And based on that, we will design that member. Okay, one-way sway and two-way sway. Basically, one-way sway will be in one direction. That is, let's say, as a consequence of sway, the column bends in the ZZ axis only. Okay, the other direction we may have bracing or something which prevents the sway. If that is also not there, then the column may sway in that direction also. So there will be a two-way sway. But generally, we may not go into in routine design. We may not consider two-way sway directly. We try to prevent it by providing bracing or lateral members in the other direction. What is the purpose of multiplying imperfection factor in design of steel structures? So basically, as I said, real columns are not perfect. They have all those imperfections, residual stresses, etc., etc., and we are accounting for them to get strength which will be less than what is predicted by Euler's theory or for an ideal strut, so that we'll get a safe design. Okay, so that is the purpose of using the imperfection factor in design. Then another question: in a compression member with bolted connections, when compression force is applied, will there be any effect on the bolt? If the plates are butting, touching again each other, then probably the bolt may not transfer any load. But if the member is bringing shear to the bolt, then the bolts may go in shear. Okay. Again, this we will cover when we talk about design of bolts. You can also ask questions in the tutorial time if you have any questions in the future, or you can send it by email to me. Thank you.